Welcome, everyone. Glad to see you all here. My name is Arlene Stein. I'm a professor of sociology at Rutgers. I want to thank the Rutgers New Brunswick Chancellor's Office for sponsoring this talk as part of the Public Engagement Project. The PEP, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is an ongoing series of programs designed to help Rutgers faculty and graduate students develop skills to communicate their work beyond the university. Thanks to the Department of Sociology, the Program in Criminal Justice, and the School of Communication and Information for co-sponsoring this lecture. And a special shout out to Debbie Carr and Teja Pristavic, did I pronounce your name right, Teja? For helping to make this event possible. I'm delighted to introduce our speaker, Ted Conover. Ted is a journalist by trade, but he's not just any journalist. A recent piece published on the Nieman Foundation's website called him, quote, the country's reigning master of immersion reporting. He has spent the last 30 years embedding himself in different social worlds, hobos, riding the rails, undocumented migrants along the U.S.-Mexican border, snow bums in Aspen, Colorado, truck drivers in Africa. He's probably best known for having spent nearly a year working as a guard in a maximum security prison in New York and writing a book about it, which some of you may be familiar with, New Jack, Guarding Sing Sing. It won the National Book Critics Circle Award for Nonfiction and was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. Social scientists and journalists don't always see eye to eye. We sociologists tend to see journalists as people who document surface events without paying sufficient attention to context. Journalists, for their part, often view social scientists and academics in general as people who overthink things. There's some truth to each of those stereotypes, but Ted Conover, I think, defies the stereotype of the journalist who fails to offer context. He goes deep. He writes about different social worlds from the perspective of those within them. So how does it feel to work as a prison guard or a meat inspector? It's an approach that is pretty close to the methods that sociologists and anthropologists tend to use, ethnography, participant observation, or at least some sociologists use those methods. And in fact, Ted's approach to reporting emerged out of his anthropology studies in college, which is where I first met him. He was legendary for having written a book, or a senior thesis that became a book, that entailed riding the rails as a hobo. And it became his first book, Rolling Nowhere. Subsequent books include Coyotes, Whiteout, The Roots of Man, and as I said, New Jack, and it continued his trademark style, which he calls immersion reporting. He also contributes to the New York Times Magazine, Harper's, The Atlantic, Vanity Fair, and the New Yorker, and also the Moth Radio Hour. A recipient of a Guggenheim Fellowship, he teaches at the Arthur L. Carter Journalism Institute at New York University. Ted's new book is called Immersion, A Writer's Guide for Going Deep. In that book, he takes us into his writing process and offers us a way to connect deep observation and lively narrative. The title of his talk this afternoon is Thinking Like a Social Scientist, Writing Like a Journalist, Tales from the Field. Please join me in welcoming Ted Conover.
In addition to the list of people Dr. Stein thanked, I'd like to thank her. For making this happen, and I'd like to thank all of you for coming on a sunny afternoon. I'm well introduced. Thank you. My latest book opens with a poem by the poet Richard Wilbur from 1970, which was a time of great political turmoil in the United States. When I chose this poem to open my book, I had no idea we would again be in a period of political unrest and frequent protests. But now that we are, I'm happier than ever with how this book begins. It's from a poem called For the Student Strikers, written for the Wesleyan Strike News, spring 1970. Go talk with those who are rumored to be unlike you, and whom it is said you are so unlike. Let the new sound in our streets be the patient sound of your discourse. In 1970, the protests on American campuses were about Vietnam and civil rights. Today they're different. We seem to have at least two angry politicized groups in the United States, one a class of students and urbanites, and another a disaffected and unhappy mass of Trump voters who many of us assume share the many objectionable qualities of their candidate. The president last week said the press is the enemy of the American people. As I see it, this presents us with two important jobs. One is to keep calling out his lies and half-truths. Another is to work among those we might disagree with and conduct and create a journalism that lends three dimensions not only to the Trump voter, but to those many people who don't believe in Democrat or Republican or Trump, who didn't vote because they couldn't put their hearts into it. We can tell some of their stories, and we don't need to wait for magazines or websites or even professors to assign them to us. A great thing about being a student is that you still have some flexibility in terms of arranging your life in many cases. You can step outside of your comfort zone with pen in hand and listen to stories. You can ask questions and try to figure out why. One way to do this, I propose, is with more immersion journalism. Immersion reporting, to quote somebody who was writing about me, gives you access to the nuance that turns a stereotype into a real person. And that's what we need to do with undocumented migrants, corrections officers, and many other kinds of people as well. I began doing journalism in junior high school and high school. My university didn't offer any courses in it, but what they did have was anthropology, which I'd known nothing of until then. Anthropology tends to look at human differences in terms of culture and is very much concerned with the ways in which people of one culture can come to understand another. Ethnography, an anthropological or sociological description of a culture, is conducted through field work that involves interviews but also stresses participation. In fact, as Arlene Stein said, the field method is called participant observation, and that's a very great self-explanatory term which suggests two poles at the end of a line, one participant and one observer. And it's a pretty intuitive concept. If you are on the football team, you are a participant. If you are in the stands, you're an observer. If you're at home watching on TV, you're a different kind of observer, right? And that's probably, let's just say that's the furthest kind of observer you could be. I suppose you could be recently arrived and know nothing of this football team, maybe even of the sport. That would send you further out. But on the edge there, you're watching on TV. To be in the stadium takes you a little closer to participation, right? You feel the people stamping on the stands. You hear the cheers. You might cheer yourself. You might be cheering for your team. You might get caught up in the spirit of the thing. And if you do, you move a little bit over. Let's say you've been assigned by the newspaper to write about the game, and you have a place on the field, or you've been able to visit the locker room. Then you're further over on the participant side of things, right? And you get to see things a little better, a little more intimately. Of course, to be all the way over would be to be a football player. In a way, you might think, well, the very best knowledge is available to the football player because football player knows exactly what's going on and knows all this behind-the-scenes information. But what we find in life is that the people involved in a thing aren't always the best ones at explaining it, right? You can be, if you're completely a participant, you don't always understand what other people don't get about what you do. You don't always understand where they're coming from. Your head is in the thing itself. And so that's why, coming from the outside, you actually can add value by your outsider perspective, as long as you don't go too far. What's going too far? Well, if you are the school football correspondent and you end up joining the team as a trainer, that's getting pretty close to the subject, maybe a little too close. If you become a football player, forget about it. It's like in the old days of anthropology when somebody would go to the South Sea Island and they learn the language, right? They're moving in the right direction. They're eating some of that interesting food they've never seen before. They're learning a whole new way of living. They're taking their notes. They're writing home. But after a couple of years, they decide, oh, I like it here so much, maybe I'll stay. They take a local spouse. They have children. They don't think of home anymore. You know the phrase for this, right? Somebody. Going native, exactly. If you're going native, you're all the way over. You're losing perspective. You're not talking to the people back here anymore. So a lot of journalists, I think the criticism is often valid. Journalism often has a short deadline. Journalists often have a short attention span. Not always, but sometimes. There's an energy that comes from having to process something new all the time, a new set of facts, a new circumstance, breaking news. Love that phrase. And it doesn't, it's not always compatible with deep understanding. So my idea is you take the value that a journalist can bring, which is explaining something to a general person who's not a specialist in any one field, and then you add deeper knowledge. And in particular, I've tried to do this with subjects that seem to need attention. So it's hard to bring readers to certain serious subjects, like prison, for example. Prison is not a subject everybody wants to read about before they go to sleep at night. Immigration involves lots of controversy, lots of frustration. If you're an immigrant dealing with the U.S. Regulatory or government apparatus, it also involves anger, I think, on the part of a lot of American voters who feel our laws aren't respected. And so there again, it's a serious subject. It's a subject of great consequence. Not everybody wants to read a whole book about it on their spring vacation. What I've tried to do by placing myself in the story is find a way for the reader to connect in the way I, as a reporter, can connect with the story. This all started back in college for me. I asked my anthropology professors if I could do field work on freight trains by riding the rails and getting to know people who did that all the time. They pointed out quite accurately that that was against the law and not very safe. So I couldn't argue. I accepted that, but I had a backup position, which was, well, what if I left college and took lots of notes, and when I came back, I discussed writing an ethnography of railroad tramps with you. And they said, okay, try that. And I don't think they really thought I would or that I would stick with it, but I did. It was something I'd wanted to do for a long time. I wanted to see if a person who had done very little in his whole life except go to school had the wherewithal to live in such a different and challenging way. I wanted to see if I could talk to people unlike me who did that all the time. Some of my friends were doubtful that any of them would talk to me. And then I wanted to see if I could figure out a way to write about it that was true and that broadened our understanding of people who live like that. Because there's lots of stereotypes, right? There's the Halloween hobo with the stick and the handkerchief. And the coal on the face. They're sort of scary, whiskery hobos missing teeth and fighting with railroad police in a lot of movies. And then there's the Big Rock Candy Mountain kind of hobo. That's an old American folk song about how life out there away from civilization has lots of appeals. Nobody's going to bother you. You don't have to work. It's this idea of pure freedom. It's this sort of libertarian idea, and it's a sort of idea associated with the American frontier when a lot of work was done by casual labor and people traveling alone to where the work needed to be done. Anyway, I was interested in all of that. I was interested to know if hobos felt pushed out or if they had chosen to live that way. And so I headed out. I started in Morristown, where my Aunt Jan lived on a little farm. To me, that was like On the Road, another American book I liked a lot, where Jack Kerouac stopped and saw his aunt, I think in Patterson, on his way west. I started hitchhiking to St. Louis because I thought it would be easier to catch freight trains out there. The second ride I got was with a young woman close to my age who, after lunch, revealed that she had stolen the car. It was a relative's car. She was tired of living in Maryland, and she was headed west, and I was welcome to stay with her in the car as long as I wanted. I said, well, I'm just going to St. Louis, and I was really, really scared that I would get arrested along with her for stealing the car. I didn't. It took me 3 days in St. Louis to figure out how to catch a train. It's not like in the movies where it's rolling by and you jump on. The ones rolling by that I could see were rolling really fast. The others were stopped and not going anywhere. Very first train I caught rolled about a quarter mile onto a little siding and then stopped, and I heard this big, and that means the engine's disconnected and it's left your train cars behind. So I wasn't very good at it, and this is another, this is a great lesson to me. When you're doing this kind of work, you need to learn from people who are good at it, right? And so you may be a college student, you may have gotten good grades, but you don't know how to catch a train. That person over there who hasn't had a bath in a while and doesn't have much money in his pocket and maybe didn't finish high school knows exactly what you need to know. And so you have to figure out how to talk to him and get advice, all the while keeping yourself safe. And so so I learned. I came back to school. I wrote the ethnography. I wrote it in the third person, which was the requirement of my professors. But I realized when I did that I was not answering the questions of a lot of my friends. So you were riding the rails all last semester. Did you get arrested? Did you ever get hurt? Were you ever scared? How did you catch the train anyway? And I thought there's more here I want to write. I wrote an article for a student magazine. It got picked up by the Associated Press. Ended up resulting in some calls from shows like All Things Considered. And the Today Show called and asked if I would talk about my experience, and I thought, well, maybe this is my chance to try to sell a book about the same experience, but with the added dimension of what it was like to make that passage, right? Long story short, it worked out. I did that. I went to graduate school afterwards on a scholarship in England for a couple of years. And I was thinking about that time when David Bowie died last year. He had a song that was famous among people of my generation. It might have been the first song to, a popular song to employ a stutter. And the song is called Changes, which he pronounced ch-ch-ch-changes. Some of you have heard this. The first line of the song, I had misunderstood my entire life until I got to England and heard somebody sing it and say, turn and face the strange. That's the first line of that song. And I liked how Bowie did that, because Bowie was strange, right? Bowie was a strange guy, and part of his song was saying, pay attention to people like me. I think he was endorsing the idea that all of us should try to understand what's unfamiliar, unknown to us, and possibly even frightening, whether it's people who aren't gender normative or people with different skin tones. Anyway, that's the epigraph of the next section of my book, Turn and Face the Strange. I tell about how it started on trains with me. And then when I got back in the U.S., I'd already had an idea for my next book, because on the trains I'd met a lot of Mexicans who seemed to be just like the hobos, except they were from Mexico. And I was especially interested in them because the hobos said they weren't hobos at all. They weren't part of the hierarchy they used to understand their world. The tramp travels and works. The hobo doesn't travel. Excuse me, the hobo travels but doesn't work. The bum doesn't travel and doesn't work. That's the hierarchy on the rails. And I remember asking one of the tramps, well, what about a Mexican? Mexican's a Mexican. And behind that, I thought, there's a book. Mexican's not just a Mexican. A Mexican is the whole next wave of American immigration. And because I discovered Mexicans I met when I was traveling alone on the rails would talk to me in my Denver Public Schools Spanish, I was thinking maybe I could spend a while traveling with them. And I did. I started with a farm worker group in Arizona that believed you could organize undocumented people, unlike the United Farm Workers, which felt it was too risky because they could be deported. The Arizona farm workers thought you could organize undocumented people if you had enough of them in a concentrated area, and they organized citrus workers outside Phoenix. I offered to teach English classes, which they told me a lot of their members wanted after work in the orchards. A lot of them slept under these orange and lemon trees. And I ended up taking my first trips with the people who I was trying to teach English as they were trying to improve my Mexican Spanish, which is different from other forms of Spanish. It includes a lot of swear words I had not been taught in school. Many of them forms of the verb chingar, which can be conjugated very creatively in very many ways, each with its own particular meaning. And when they heard me say those things, they thought it was hilarious, and that helped us get along. And It was actually the best research experience I've had because the people I was with were a lot like me, about the same age. They hadn't been traumatized like a lot of the railroad tramps had been by the Vietnam War or homelessness. They came from intact families in southern Mexico, and they looked after me, which I appreciated. In fact, the only time I got hurt on that whole year of travel with them was a night we flew from Phoenix to Los Angeles. We grabbed a taxi at the airport because the guy who was supposed to pick them up wasn't there. Cheapest destination was Santa Monica. We sat in a donut shop at about 2 a.m. I taught them how to play dots. You know that game, dots? It's a good game for a donut shop at 2 a.m. A drunken white guy with a one sort of puffy eye, wearing a leather jacket, came in and stood next to our booth and looked at them, and then he looked at me and said, I said, yeah, can I help you? And he said, white guy talking to Mexicans. And I said, yeah, got a problem with that? And he said, no problem. And he walked away. We went back to our game, and I'd forgotten about him 5 or 10 minutes later when he came back and punched me in the face. When the uncle of one of my companions who was, then he ran out of the donut shop. When we were finally picked up, the uncle of one of the guys I was with, we told the story, misunderstood. He assumed that a Mexican had punched me. And when they said, no, you know, it wasn't a cuate, it was a gabacho, it was a white guy, and it was the funniest thing he ever heard, which didn't make me feel much better, but the incident by itself taught me something about racism that I had not expected, and that I don't think I would have learned in any other way. I'm going to abbreviate some of the projects I did after that. After that book, Coyotes, I moved up to Aspen, Colorado, which was booming with lots of movie stars. This rich guy, Donald Trump, was there with his wife, Ivana. I know. What was the phrase you used this morning, Arlene? Reporting up? No, not reporting. Researching up? Studying up? So social scientists sometimes study less privileged people, sometimes more privileged. This was my experiment in seeing if I could do research among the wealthy. I drove a taxi. I worked at the newspaper in Aspen. I catered parties. I snuck into a fancy New Year's party by using the name of a drug dealer I knew had been arrested the week before and would not be attending. And I had some good adventures. It was hard to leave. But I think overall it taught me that people with a lot of money are not necessarily happier than people without it, and also made me long for a subject that seemed to have more importance going forward about the state of the world. I moved to New York. I started getting magazine assignments. My college roommates had fallen in love with each other right before the AIDS epidemic got bad. They moved to San Francisco at the wrong time and both got AIDS. One died shortly thereafter, and I wanted to write about AIDS. So I proposed to the New Yorker a piece about long-distance truck drivers in East Africa and how they negotiate illness. They had been identified as carriers of HIV. They were still more likely to die of malaria when I joined a convoy of them for a 6-week trip. But AIDS was definitely on their radar. They had lots of misperceptions about it. They thought I was obsessed with the subject because I asked about it all the time. Every night they would stop at lodgings on this road between Mombasa and Rwanda. And the women who served them there were often available for sex afterwards and would often ask why I wasn't interested. And the guys would say, he's obsessed with AIDS. It's all he can talk about. And some would say, well, that's irrelevant. Look at me. I'm fine. I'm not sick at all. And then they just say, well, you know, he's strange. He's a different kind of guy. And he doesn't want to sleep with anybody. And that was great. It was a lot of pressure, especially if you have money. To not spend it in that way was a real problem. When I moved to New York, I noticed all the headlines about record numbers of people being incarcerated, the racial nature of the incarceration, and I thought, how can I report about this firsthand? I thought the best books about prison have been written by prisoners. George Jackson, Eldridge Cleaver, Mumia Abu-Jamal, who's the one Norman Mailer helped? Belly of the Beast. We'll remember. Anyway, I thought, I don't think I can become a prisoner because I don't want to commit a crime and I want to be able to leave prison after a while, but I thought maybe I could become an officer. It took me 3 years, but I did. I didn't lie on the application, which is important if you're doing something surreptitious. It's important not to lie. I didn't tell them I'd written books, but they didn't ask, and so I spent almost a year working at Sing Sing in Ossining on the Hudson River. Super, super hard job. It's especially hard if you're not very big, which I'm not. And I couldn't talk about it either because I was afraid of getting discovered and losing the job or, you know, running into some kind of trouble in the parking lot after work if people learned I was really a journalist. So I've often been asked, you know, why do you keep doing these things when it can be so unpleasant? Like working in a prison is really unpleasant. And I address this in the first chapter of my book. I'm just going to read you a page and a half here. Granted, the difficulty is a given. People don't always want to talk to let you in. Not everybody you get to know will turn out to be a person you're glad to know. Sometimes conditions are uncomfortable. Often there are long stretches of waiting and tedium. You might become lonely, you might get sick. Staying home or going to the office in nice clothes would no doubt be easier, but oh, so much less interesting. A case in point. One evening when I was working as a CO at Sing Sing, I came home, collapsed on the couch, and turned on the TV. I'd had a long day dealing with stubborn and angry prisoners, not to mention fellow corrections officers who had second-guessed some of my decisions in a way I would not describe as supportive. On the screen was a presidential news conference. The reporters looked well-dressed, alert, more engaged than stressed. I'd been in that briefing room years before as an intern at U.S. News and World Report and might have followed that path. The shouting of questions in between the president's answers was a bit chaotic, but nobody in the briefing room was going to get slugged or shanked. Everyone seemed more or less collegial, and briefly I felt envious. But after a good meal and a hot shower, that feeling went away. What I was doing was unpredictable, trying, sometimes frightening, but almost every single day I came home having seen or heard something remarkable that my friends could scarcely imagine. One day it was the young inmate who said to me, as I escorted him down the corridor to a medical appointment and asked about his bid, "CO, I'm going to be here till the sun burns out." Another day it was the quick response of a fellow officer who saw an inmate run into me and wasn't sure if it had been intentional. If it had, he was ready to subdue him for me, to put his own body on the line, no questions asked. Or the realization that grew over several months about how, despite the fact that I was a small cog in a big correctional machine, I had an important choice to make. As I wrote in New Jack, it took time and confrontations to decide or to discover what kind of person was going to be wearing your uniform, a hard ass or a softy, inmate's friend or inmate's enemy, straight or crooked, a user of force or a writer of tickets, a strict overseer or a lender of hands. The job was full of discretionary power, and the decisions about how to use it were often moral. Could I have learned that any other way? Well, maybe, but it would have meant less to me as a writer because I would have been hearing about somebody else's experiences instead of parsing my own. Research doesn't have to be as secretive or intensely immersive as mine was in prison to yield valuable insights. After New Jack, I wrote a book called The Roots of Man about roads in different parts of the world and the meaning of six really interesting roads. I accompanied a student in Ramallah on a weekend visit home to his parents' house in Hebron and spent several days with an ambulance crew posted to a highway intersection in Lagos. You know what? I skipped a sentence. For chapters on West Bank checkpoints and Nigerian traffic, respectively, in The Roots of Man, I accompanied a student in Ramallah and spent several days with an ambulance crew posted to a highway intersection in Lagos. Everybody knew I was a foreign journalist. In those settings, and most others, I could never pretend otherwise. The point is that by simply spending time with people, being at their sides as they encounter challenging situations, by hanging out, in other words, you learn a lot more about them than you might by only conducting interviews. By eating with them, traveling with them, breathing their air, you get more than just information, you gain shared experience and often powerful stories. I want to leave time for questions. I know there's a lot of pressure on journalists everywhere to write short and publish often. Immersion writing usually isn't possible on a very short deadline, but there are ways to do shorter versions of it. You can watch somebody interesting over a smaller stretch of time. A student of mine helped teach a class of Muslim women in Brooklyn taking their U.S. citizenship test last fall. They were trying to pass the test because they thought, what struck me as ridiculous at the time, if they couldn't pass before the election, Trump might win, and then it would be harder. Take a trip with somebody interesting whose life is in the news. I was able to take a trip with a Chinese driving club, people who had recently learned how to drive and wanted to go somewhere together fast. That was actually a lot of fun. Relatives going to visit people in prison on a bus. Do you know somebody who has to check in at an ICE office sometime soon? Maybe you could go with them. There's lots of creative ways to be a journalist. It's not all about just doing interviews, getting quotes, and doing a quick story. The last thing that I think is a coming thing is first-person narration. The world seems to slowly be going first-person with blogs, comment sections, Facebook, the web. There's more first-person than ever. Memoir and personal essay are ascendant. Does your first person belong in the news? Does first person narration hold the possibility of making people more interested in what you're writing about? You should think about whether you can make sure that it does. I think that by crossing the border myself with Mexicans, I brought a lot of English-speaking readers to that story who might not have been interested in it. I think that by working in a prison, I bring along readers who otherwise might not be willing to go there. The risk in a lot of first-person writing is that you make yourself the hero and the star, right? Look at me. Look at my grand adventures. Aren't I fantastic? That is the biggest stumbling block, especially when you're starting out with this. You can be in the story without being the hero of a story. You can be in the story as a person who's meeting people, who's learning things, who's being humbled by his bad decisions about which train to catch or which inmate to pick a fight with, or who can't keep up with the other guys picking oranges because it's really hard work. And I actually got fired from picking oranges because I was too slow. These are all things it would be hard to write about if you were not writing about your own experience. You just need to remember some of the best writing doesn't have that first person as the star of the show, but the first person is there as some kind of witness. Sometimes it's said that on universities we live in a bubble. I think the best universities are a sort of global bubble with cosmopolitan ideas and people from around the world. Spending time in these bubbles is a privilege, one that can imbue us with specialized knowledge that allows us to make a contribution to the world. But bubbles can also insulate us from people unlike ourselves and their disaffection. I think journalism can be a cure for what ails us and can make itself newly relevant by sending people outside the bubble and into those worlds of the disaffected or those who can't be bothered. You can step outside of your own comfort zone with pen in hand and listen to stories. You can ask questions and try to figure out why. Thank you for listening to my brief talk, and I would be happy to answer any questions you might have.
For the talk, I really enjoy so much. I'm a doctoral student from Urban Planning and then Public Policy Department, and I've got three questions for you, and that's a question that I struggle a lot as a social scientist. So the first question would be, like, is there any time that you struggle, like, to compromise the speed, like, with the depth of the knowledge that when you get into field work, that you know that you have a limited time, that you have to get outcomes. So, like, did you compromise with the depth of the research?
Yeah. So, I think another way to say that might be, am I always able to stay as long as I want? Is that another way to say it?
Yes. And when do you know that that's far more enough that you have to finish your research there?
So it's a little different if you're writing a dissertation or a master's thesis or if you're doing an article for Harper's Magazine. If it's an article for a magazine, they usually tell you how long it should be. Or if you're going to interest them with your article, you read the magazine first and see how long their articles are. And then you know, then you have a target. So sometimes you don't know what you're writing, though, and you think, oh, it could be an article, it could be a book. I spent 3 years becoming a USDA meat inspector. I wanted to write about how meat is made. And I knew Harper's Magazine was interested, but I also thought, this took me so long, and it's such an interesting subject, I bet I could write a whole book. So I went to the first place that would take me, which was a Cargill Meat Solutions factory in Schuyler, Nebraska. And I stayed for 7 weeks. I worked in a slaughterhouse. Now, inspectors have to cut in. It's a beef slaughterhouse. Inspectors have to cut beef just like workers, but not at the same pace. And they get to change during the day. If I hadn't been able to change the job during the day, I wouldn't have lasted 2 weeks. As it was, I was enduring a lot of pain in my arms in the second month when I got a letter from the government saying now they were going to conclude my background check. And I could tell from the questions I would never pass the deep background check, because I can't lie. And they wanted to talk to my last employer, a close relative, a friend, and a neighbor. And I couldn't have those people, you know, not lie for me. So I had to quit. I had to quit. And I thought, well, now that I don't work in the factory, I can still stay in the town. It's a fascinating place. It used to be all descendants of people from Middle Europe, Central Europe, and now it's 90% Latino, mostly Central American. I thought, well, I can research this now, but everybody thought I was a meat inspector, not a journalist. And there were only like 500 people in the town, so I couldn't do that either. All I had was an article. I had to stop. You're asking a different question, but it's such a difficult question depending on the situation. I think as a writer, you need to think, what piece of this story do I want to tell? And what piece of it can I realistically tell in the time available to me? You don't have the next 10 years, I imagine. Maybe you have the summer. Maybe you have 4 months. How much can you realistically do in the time you've got? Maybe you're an undergraduate studying journalism and you just have a week until your next assignment is due. Is that possible? Is that a reasonable scenario, Mary? Yeah. So what could you reasonably do? You have to think what's possible. I'm sorry I can't answer better than that.
That was really helpful. And the second question is related to that. So access to the community that you want to study about. So I think that you keep changing your role. And was there any kind of like a professional experience that you like wish to have in order to have more access to certain communities?
Yes, I've had lots of ideas and I couldn't get access. I'm always thinking of ideas. I got turned down for a job I had thought of a long time ago, last spring. I didn't get hired. I think a reason is the internet. I think they figured me out.
The last one, yeah. So, yeah, that's the third question. Oh, so so you mentioned that you choose like a very interesting topic that needs some audience attention, right? And if there's a topic that needs to draw like audience attention, but that if that's not interesting, how do you deal with this issue?
Oh, do you have an example?
So, for example, like I'm studying urban planning, like master plan in Vietnam, and then this planning case is a dying case that journalists used to be interested to report that. Yeah, there are a lot of money going into this site, but now, like because of the political situations, it's not going to be implemented.
Uh-huh.
So nobody pay attention on that.
Right.
But we don't talk about the tax we wasted on this plan. We don't argue about this past experience. I mean, like past events that we've been working on. I mean, as a professional, like urban planner, so I was like wondering if that's the case, then how do you figure out the.
It's not within the power of every writer to take a topic that's off the radar and put it on the radar. Some of them are just too difficult or too obscure or too far from the concerns of an average reader. And when you, so choosing a topic is very important, and you try to find a topic that you think you can make people care about. One of the luxuries of academic research is you don't have to consider the market for a particular article, right? It can be interesting for other reasons inside your profession, but if you're aiming for a general audience, you do have to consider that in advance. Often, the situation of an individual person can be a key to making a story more vivid.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. While the microphone is traveling, if you live in near Maplewood, I'm going to be at the Words Bookstore on Thursday night at 7:30 signing my books, if anybody feels like dropping by. Hi.
Hi. So I know you touched on it a little bit, but do you think you would ever feel as fulfilled in your career as you do now, doing something similar to a traditional journalist, like you mentioned, watching something that you could be doing like with your colleagues, like on TV, like being a typical journalist? Do you think you'd ever be as fulfilled as you are now in your career?
It's so hard to say. Like right now, so much is up in the air with journalism. You know, it has been for the last 5 or 10 years as the digital revolution has overtaken print journalism and changed things. But now, with a presidential administration that seems in some ways to wish journalists didn't exist, though in other ways seems to need journalism to be famous, it's an extremely challenging and exciting time. I've got to say, one reason we all talk about politics so much these days is there's so much happening almost every day, right? And there's all kinds of thinking needed to sort it out and think what is the best journalism in this particular moment. So I think if I worked for a big newspaper or a TV station, or if I was one of those people in the White House briefing room, I think I would still be pretty interested.
Okay, yeah. Great, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. It's true. No, it's a really good question. So, I have always loved to travel, and I've loved to travel in that kind of on-the-ground way where you don't know where you'll be that night or who you'll be with. I still like that. And one of the great ironies of having done that kind of travel and published about it is when I moved to New York, I got assignments from travel magazines that wanted to send me to expensive resorts. Not the worst thing in the world, but it really has no connection to the reasons I became known for travel writing. Like, none. Still, it sent me on some good trips. I think travel writing is changing a lot now as people in the most far-flung parts of the world have smartphones with cameras and access to the internet and can post, obviously, their own accounts of life there and breaking news there. And you don't need travel writing in the same way you did in the Victorian era, right? When a globe-trotting guy from Oxford could go anywhere in the Commonwealth and send back exciting tales. So that kind of travel writing, which there was a vogue for in the 70s and 80s, maybe even into the 90s, I think that's waned, but I still think that travel, that road stories are an important indigenous American literary form. I don't think that's going to change. I think American audiences love a road story, whether it's Blue Highways or Travels with Lisbeth or, there's just so many. There are more to be written, and maybe I'll write another one. I don't know. I've been corresponding with a French priest who organized a trip into Mexico with anybody who wanted to go with him. He just said, come join me. I can't remember where they started. They traveled for like 3 weeks. And that idea of not only sort of random destinations, but random companions was pretty fascinating. I think there's great drama in meeting the next person down the road. You just have no idea who that person could be or how they might change your life, whether they'll travel with you or not. So thanks for bringing that up. There's no academic connection to road stories, really. So I wasn't talking about them too much tonight, but that is in my blood, and that's kind of what got me started. Yeah. Oh, shoot. I think if we talk into the microphone, it ends up on the video, which is good for somebody. You're going to get some exercise, Arlene.
I'm curious, when you were riding the rails, how did you present yourself? Did you tell them that you were a journalist, or did they think you were one of them?
Good question. A good rule of thumb is to be transparent and honest about who you are whenever you can. And that's how I started on the rails. I didn't wear the same clothes I wore as an undergraduate, but I wore, I tried to fit in. But then when I got to know people, I'd say, yeah, look, I started this last week. I don't really know what I'm doing. Any advice would be great. And I think it was at the end of the second week, I met a guy when we got off a train in Lincoln, Nebraska, who said, you know, I'm glad you told me that, but you should stop telling that to people, because there's some guys who are going to hear that you don't know what that you're doing, and they're going to take advantage of you. There's other guys who are going to hear that you say you are a college student, and they're going to think you're bragging and trying to sound better than them. He said, why don't you just keep it to yourself? And I said, okay. Maybe that's good advice. So I guess that is then what I started to do, is really just not talk about me, right? Just not go into detail. I'd say, yeah, I'm just doing this for a while. How about you? And the good thing is that there's a lot of people in our world who are not asked about themselves very often. And if you're willing to listen, if you're a good listener, there's a lot of people willing to talk. So, I did stop fully explaining myself when I was riding the rails. Yeah. Maybe she could pass it behind her. Yeah.
I'm interested in hearing a little bit more about your experience studying people at the Aspen. These are people who are used to being asked all the time about themselves, and I wonder if you could just talk about some differences in the qualities of interactions and personal relationships you were able to establish with them in comparison to some of your other projects, kind of obstacles or constraints. It's really fascinating for anthropologists, especially, to hear about that.
Oh, good. So here's the thing. in Aspen, everybody assumes I belong. And I grew up in Colorado. I know how to ski. I didn't own a mountain bike, but when I got to Aspen, I bought one, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The first problem I had, I was driving a Chevy Suburban for the Mellow Yellow Taxi Company. And a lot of the drivers thought I was a narc because they sell a lot of drugs. And I didn't write this in the book, but that's why they were afraid I was a narc. And so that was a problem there. I had been to Aspen as an author, having published two books at the invitation of the Aspen Writers Conference, and gave a talk open to the public in which I said this could be a great town to write a book about. And a lot of people agreed with me in the audience and said they'd help me if I ever did that. So when I did return to do that very thing, I was out, right? Maybe I was working at the Aspen Times, but and I wouldn't tell everybody who I went to interview as a reporter, but people I got to know, I explained what I was up to, that I'd written these other books. I want to see if I can write an ethnography of paradise. And so what were the challenges? One was so many of the people I hung out with they were like people I would naturally be friends with. So there were a couple of women I started going out with. And once you do that, you can't write about them. And so then you have to... So then there's an area of self-censorship, it seems to me. I would never write about somebody I'd been romantically involved with, unless it was a memoir I have yet to write. And even then, I doubt it. Where it was over the top, it was easy. So at that party I went to on New Year's Eve where I said I used the name of this drug dealer, the room was full of beautiful people, and I was sitting at a table next to an extremely attractive woman who complained that the band was playing too many songs by Jimmy Buffett. This will tell you, this will set it in time, right? It was like early 90s. And on the other side of me, the woman said, well, that is Jimmy Buffett. That's why. And so that's the kind of story that's easy to tell. And it's enlightening, right? You see that. And you meet people who have so many choices, they're paralyzed by the options available to them. Should I go to Bali next week with my, my best girlfriend, or should I go to Moab instead in the mud season? Or should I do that retreat, right? Like, people there don't talk about the work they do. That's what you do everywhere else in the United States. Hi, what do you do? I'm a journalist. What do you do? I'm a professor. I'm a graduate student. In Aspen, it's like, where are you going next? Or where are you just back from? So in some ways, you can, if you're listening carefully, you start to realize this is a different kind of discourse than I'm used to. But in other ways, it was just pleasant. Like, the lack of danger or risk is hard to write about. when you're not being challenged, except, I don't know, eat well and some people who like my books like Whiteout least. My son last week finally read Whiteout and said this might be my favorite book, he told me. I was really surprised. He said, you tell much more about yourself in that book than in the other books. And I said, oh, I had no idea. I don't feel I've given you a very good answer. Maybe way in the back there. Hi. Do you care, Arlene? Speak out loud. Oh, sure. So that's it. You raise a question that's at the heart of these books based on participation, right? I'm visiting a life. It's not my life, really. It's not what I'm going to be doing in 3 years. There was a night I came home from Sing Sing and my wife said, "What, you know, how was today?" And I said, "Oh, it was pretty good. I signed up to take the sergeant exam." And she said, "Why did you do that?" And I said, "Well, they only offer it every 5 years. If I didn't sign up, I might never have gotten the chance." And she said, "You said you're just going to do this until next year." And I said, "Yeah, but you never know. I mean, everything could change, and I might need a job like that. I might as well be a sergeant." And she said, "You've got to be kidding." Like, it made her really mad that in my mind I was thinking, I'd rather be a sergeant. But of course, I'd rather be a sergeant. The job was so demanding that on a sort of minute-to-minute or hour-to-hour basis, I didn't think of it as an experiment or a temporary state. This was my job. It was hard to do. I wasn't as good at it as other people I worked with, which was frustrating because I think of myself as being extra good at things sometimes. And at the end of the day, when I'd go home and I'd type up my notes, that would help me put it in perspective and think, okay, right, I'm a writer. This is what I need to remember. That was interesting. I'm going to put this in boldface because I might want to use it when I write my book. But then, I don't know, often writing my notes would take half an hour, 45 minutes, less than an hour. Then I'm off to take care of my kids and try to get dinner and sleep and get back to work not exhausted, right? So it's this, I also really get into these different roles. A friend said, "You're like an actor." And I thought, well, yeah, but no, because I have to be in this identity for 8 or 10 hours a day, or if it's around the clock, even longer. And when I was finished being a corrections officer, the day I quit, I thought I would be really happy. And I wasn't. I had to turn in my uniforms, and a guy I had just trained the week before, a guy straight out of the academy, saw me turning in my uniform. And he looked crestfallen, like, "You're leaving me?" You know? And part of me felt exactly that, like I was leaving this strange dangerous culture on a remote island where I'd never return, and all the language I'd learned, all the cultural understandings I'd never use again. And because I was leaving, things there wouldn't work quite as well for a few days as they had been, because I had figured stuff out, right? All those people who... some new Jack would come in who didn't know anything, and he'd do a worse job. So I felt badly. And that's real, right? So I was invested in the job, but I could also step back at the end of the day and said, well, I don't feel like I thought I would. And so you have this double quality when you do a project like that. Part of it is right in the moment, and part of it is looking at yourself from up there and thinking, okay, Ted made it through that day. I wonder how he'll do tomorrow. I didn't have many bad dreams in prison, but once I stopped working there, I started having lots of them about often being locked up myself. Occasionally, I'd be pursued, like in a public place, by prisoners. I think a friend suggested to me it's a result of repressing my fear when I was in there. If you repress this, it'll come back later. And so that stuff's all real. Yes, I could quit next week, but I didn't, and I wouldn't have, because I knew I had to stay for months if I was going to make a book out of it. So it's some mixture of pretend and real, and I'm not sure I can describe it better than that, but it was hard to leave, and I still think about it all the time. Does that answer your question a little bit? Maybe one more question here? Sure. Yeah. Yeah. So the question is, how did it impact my family? Well, Sing Sing happened at an inopportune time. I'd taken the civil service exam. I didn't know when I'd be called. We just had our second child when I got called. And my wife had a full-time job, so we had a big childcare challenge at the time. My wife, when I met her, knew about my predilections. I'd already published the hobo book, and she had read it. And she's a person who doesn't get frightened for me, which is lucky. She knows I'm actually quite cautious, which might sound unlikely, but I am. I really don't want to get hurt. And at the same time, if you're gone from home, especially if you have little kids, for more than a month, that's bad. So for my book before this, for The Roots of Man, I needed to spend 2 months in Peru and at least 2 months in the Himalayas. And in each case, I divided it in half, so I'd never be gone more than a month at a time. And instead of finishing the whole book research in a year, I could have probably done the whole thing in a year. I spread it out over almost 3 years. So it lowered my income, but it increased my time with my kids, and I'm still married. So, yeah, there's no way around that. You just can't be gone too long or things suffer. Yeah. Thank you for the good questions and for talking.